Hi, I'm Nick Jacobs, the treasurer of the American Board of Integrative Holistic Medicine, and this morning I'm going to be talking a little bit about the future of healthcare and what impacts it we'll be facing over the next several years. So a little over a year ago, the two highest inflationary indicators in the United States were coffee and orange juice and biotech products. And one of the reasons for that was that the previous year there had been a frost and there had been damage to the crops. But in the biotech product area, it was because of increased demand and the prices were higher because of that. And so what's that really all about? Well, in this presentation, I want to talk about the fact that quantitative is meeting qualitative. And virtually, systems biology is going to be intertwined with integrative medicine and whole systems healing as we move forward. So I went to the dentist a few weeks ago and we were talking and I said, so how are you doing? He's been my dentist for a quarter of a century. And he said, well, he said, I had a really interesting experience. I took a continuing medical education course and for the very first time ever, they talked about the fact that the mouth is connected to the body. And in that process, we discussed the fact that every day we were seeing people with inflammatory disease, but not communicating with their primary care physicians. And as we know, inflammatory disease is a major problem for many people in this world. And he said, so that I got back on Monday morning and the first patient I saw with inflammatory disease, I called and I reached their MD and I said, you know, I just wanted to let you know I'm working with Mrs. So-and-so and she's got some serious gum issues here. And the doctor said, why did you call me? And so part of what we're finding is that holistic is something that is still a challenge in terms of the medical field, the cottage industries. One of my great opportunities of my life was getting to work with Dr. Leroy Hood. And a lot of what I'll be talking about here in this presentation is assignable directly to him, not my words, not my thoughts. But Dr. Hood was the founder and the director of the Institute for Systems Biology and dedicated to identifying strategies for predicting and preventing disease. And he invented most of the instruments that we used in our biotech center. We had a world research center. And in that, the DNA sequencers and machines for synthesizing the proteins and automated tools for synthesizing DNA. So Lee's predictions were that within the next 10 years, healthcare will fundamentally change from reactive to proactive. And that's because medicine will become, in his words, predictive, personalized, preventative, and participatory. And why is that? It's because biology is evolving into an informational science, and it's not going to stop going in that direction. Proteomics and genomics will contribute to the continued morphing of our current diagnostic medicine into the new world order, and spectacular computational powers will map the 2,500 blood organ-specific proteins from the 50 organs to diagnose our patients and provide them with wellness assessments. And then from there, vaccinations will be developed as specific therapies for hundreds of different diagnoses. To give you an example of this, we're currently working on a pharmacogenomics center that's specializing in SNIP analysis, single nucleotide polymorphisms. And when you look into the actual science behind this, it's not a matter of mapping the entire genome and looking at the 30,000 genes and then giving people information that they can't alter or affect or change, but it's looking at those 300 or so genes that will determine how your body metabolizes certain medicines. And so they'll be able to monitor toxicity and response dose and combinational therapies. These types of advances in the biology world are going to be extremely significant. I mean, as a former hospital CEO, there were many, many times when the oncologist would come into my office and say, Nick, as a courtesy, I want you to know that Mrs. Jones is dying of a certain type of cancer. She signed a release here. We have a new drug that may or may not work for her. If it works, she'll need 3 doses. If it doesn't work, it'll either kill her or it just won't work. But we're not going to know until we try the drug. And by the way, those 3 doses will cost $150,000, and your reimbursement from Medicare will be about $6,200. Now, with SNP analysis, that will give us the opportunity to not introduce those drugs into the human body without knowing how they're going to be impacted, how the body's going to be impacted. You know, in 2003, when we first started our research institute, it cost us, well, it cost $3 billion to map the human genome. This year it's less than 1,000, and it's going to cost, and it cost us about $1 million for 1 terabyte of storage data for data. Now it's $16 for 2 terabytes in the cloud. So we can see things are moving quickly. They're moving exponentially fast. It was interesting because I had an opportunity to be at MIT and Harvard and do some research and worked on the Pittsburgh Tissue Engineering Institute. And I can remember walking in the first time about 8-10 years ago and seeing what looked like a can of Pringles. And when the PhD that I was talking to opened the can and laid out what was the contents of that can, it was human ears that he had grown. And regenerative medicine is empowering science to grow tissues and organs in the laboratory and then safely implant them in the body as well. So why am I talking about all this in a presentation for the American Board of Integrative Holistic Medicine? Because I do think that we have dealt for many, many, many decades now with the promise of technology. And so as we look at other things that are coming out, these little nano cell like nanofactories that are being developed, and I remember my principal investigator was at a holiday party and he ran into a gentleman, and they got to talking, and the gentleman said to him, "What do you do?" And my principal investigator said, "Well, I'm in charge of breast cancer research for the United States military." And he said, "What do you do?" And he said, "Well, Ronald Reagan hired me to create Star Wars." And they started to talk about the breast cancer issue. And one of the things that happened, which was very interesting, was that he teared up. The scientist teared up and he said, "I just lost my sister-in-law from breast cancer." And he said, "As I sit in front of my monitors every day, looking at simulations of 1,500 incoming intercontinental ballistic missiles and trying to determine which ones are decoys and which ones were warheads, I realized that I was doing mammography." And so I vow to you that I will get as many of these algorithms declassified as I can for you to do your research. And we, in fact, did get involved with some research with General Electric and others where we could literally apply these algorithms to a digitized breast cancer image and see individual cells that are broken off. Again, when you start to think about the implications of being able to remove that individual cell that would 5, 10, 15 years from now develop into a tumor, removing that with a needle, there are some tremendous things that are happening relative to science and what science is doing and what science can do. IBM has found a way to meld biology and computing to create a new chip that would become a basis for a genetic analyzer. And this DNA transistor could make it cheaper and easier to sequence individual complete human genomes. But let's talk about what I consider to be the ugly secret. You know, Richard Nixon in January of 1971, in his State of the Union address, said, "I will ask for an extra $100 million to launch an intensive campaign to find a cure for cancer." And since 1997, $45 billion has been budgeted to the NCI, bigger than the budget of Greece. And the reality is, you know, we aren't there. And one of the reasons that we aren't there is that science in this country is based on, as a musician, I can describe it best this way, kind of the diva mentality. You, the individual, are responsible for your individual research, your individual discoveries. You get the grants. You buy the equipment. You hire the people. You get upset with me and go to the next university. And for me, as the scientist, to share that with the person beside me to any great degree would be questionable, because then they may get my grant away. And so the incentives are interesting in terms of how we actually move forward in research. And so I call this the failed promise of it could be science and technology, because what options do we really have to address the major issues that are going on in healthcare right now? For example, the HCAP surveys. When you look at the new rulings that have been implemented, actually they came out of the Bush administration. When people come home from the hospital, Medicare patients come home from the hospital, they now get a survey. And on that survey, they said, were the doctors nice to you? Were the nurses, did they make you comfortable? Did you get any sleep? These are issues that had not been necessarily at the front of concern for many, many decades. But the reality now is that reimbursements are going to be tied to those HCAPs, and they're going to be tied to the quality indicators, and they're tied to infection rates, and they're tied to wellness and prevention in ways that will basically change the way at least hospitals have to do their business, and most physicians. So what about integrative holistic medicine? You know, integrative holistic medicine is the art and science of healing that addresses the care of the whole person, body, mind, and spirit, and makes available the scientific content and the database which would support integrative holistic medicine. And so, as we look at integrative medicine, we realize that it reaffirms the importance of the relationship between the practitioner and the patient. It focuses on the whole person, it's informed by evidence, and it makes use of all the appropriate therapeutic approaches. And this type of practice was virtually eliminated back in 1910, and medicine was pushed into ICD-9 and now ICD-10 codes. And it became a matter of the diagnosis of disorders leading to the prescription of drugs. I love this slide. I'm sure it's from one of my peers and colleagues, and I'm sorry I can't give credit to the person that first showed it, but you know, if you study the statistics, you'll see that China consumes less red wine than we do, but their population lives longer. And Japan consumes less fat than we do, and their population lives longer. And the Italians consume much more red wine than we do, and they live longer. And the Germans do everything wrong. They eat high fat, they drink lots of beer, they eat sausages and fats, and even they live longer than the Americans. So maybe the conclusion is living in America is the problem. But what is it that the ABIHM and that our physicians truly embrace? It's the one thing that has been dropped from many, many of the books that are necessary to become physicians in the first place. And that is the whole concept of unconditional love. Unconditional love is a term that means to love someone regardless of one's actions or beliefs. And simply stated, it's an unlimited way of being. We are without any limit to our thoughts and feelings in life, and we can create any reality that we choose to focus our attention upon. So let's talk about it. Americans spent $33.9 billion out of pocket on complementary and alternative medicines over the previous 12 months. And complementary and alternative medicine only accounts for approximately 1.5% of the total healthcare expenditures, but it represents 11.2% of total out-of-pocket expenditures. So approximately 38% of adults use some form of CAM. And what we're going to see is a morphing and an embracing of complementary medicine, holistic medicine, into those facilities. It becomes a part of the solution to our nation's healthcare crisis, because through integrative holistic medicine, we provide the prevention that we preach. And so as we look at this combination of high tech and what's coming into the high tech field and what's happening in terms of that world around us, and go back to all of the things that has worked for indigenous man since the beginning of time, and we take the integrative work of all of what we know and combine it and deal with the whole body, mind, and spirit of the person, we really begin to see a morphing of healthcare that I believe could bring a bright and wonderful future to us, and that could be the solution to most of the challenges that we face. So it's where systems biology meets integrative, holistic, whole systems healing. We stop looking at individual siloed medical terms and medical cures and medical approaches, and we marry that in systems biology, and we marry that in integrative, holistic, whole system healing. And really, there are no boundaries. Thanks.